Are you stuck on how to start video editing and don't know where to begin? Maybe you've used something like Filmora or Camtasia or WeVideo or ScreenFlow or something else. Maybe you've even dabbled a little bit in the Adobe Creative Suite using Photoshop or Illustrator or one of their other programs, and you want to get started video editing using Adobe Premiere Pro, but you have absolutely no idea how to get started. Hi, I'm Jim Costa. I'm a photographer, video producer, and editor, and I've been in the television industry for over 3 decades. I bet you're a great film or video maker or YouTuber who knows that you can create great content, but just don't know how to use Premiere Pro. It looks too complicated. The interface is confusing. You've watched online tutorials and they speak a bunch of technical jargon that probably goes right over your head. If you're not a pro, how would you even know what they're talking about? Learning new software can be very frustrating, especially when you're just getting going and you're not some Hollywood professional who uses the program every day. I totally get it. I was there myself. It took me way too long and I spent way too much money trying to figure out how to use Premiere Pro. That's why I created my own Quick Start Training Guide course for Adobe Premiere Pro that'll get you up and running doing basic editing in under 2 hours. That's right, I said under 2 hours. I'm super detailed and I take you step by step through organizing all your assets even before you start, to opening the program, setting up your first project. Then I'm going to walk you through the interface and cover editing, including video, mixing, audio, music, and voice tracks, editing graphics, adding titles, rendering your project, and we'll end by saving it and then exporting it so you can upload it later. Best of all, once all that's done, I'm going to walk you through the edit of an actual online ad that I created for a client as extra practice before you start editing your own projects. After each section, I review what I've gone over, and I provide you with over 100 pro tips and keyboard shortcuts for both Apple and PC users so anyone can use the training. I want to share with you my 30 plus years of television production experience. You're going to get all this, including the full training, all the assets you'll need to start editing, which means all the video that we talk about and the sound and the graphics files and everything, keyboard shortcuts, and you'll be editing like a professional for just $29. My training is downloadable, so you can go through it at your own pace and you'll still have everything with you later. Now, if you're still not convinced, let me play for you a few minutes of what's included in the training so you can see for yourself what a valuable resource this training course can be for you. Before we can do anything, what we need to do is import assets. If you go up here, you go File, Import, we can browse to the desktop and find our assets. Remember, I saved them in a folder called Premiere Pro Quick Start Guide, and I have my assets in there. So let's start with raw footage. We'll click import. You notice you get the message saying that it is importing. If you open this up, you'll see the raw footage that we're using for this project. This little icon here takes you up a level so that you can go back to the beginning. I like to just call the folder what it is, in this case raw footage, so I can see it quickly. So I like to delete all of that. I'm going to continue to import all the assets
and I'll come back to you as soon as I'm done. Remember that the keyboard shortcut is Command-I on a Mac or Control-I on a PC. You can, of course, click File, Import if you prefer. Now, before I move on to the timeline and to this other program window, which is lit up once I dropped footage in, there's a few things about the source panel that I want to show you. There are some important buttons here. This is a play stop button right in the middle. If you click it, your footage will play. If you click it again, it'll stop. You can do the same thing by hitting the space bar. Hit the space bar once, the video footage will play. Hit the space bar again, video footage stops. These buttons here, this steps forward one frame at a time. So if I click that, notice that my footage is moving one frame at a time. And if you look over here while I do that, you'll notice I'm moving forward one frame at a time. This other button, just to the left of the play button, is step back one frame at a time. You might think that's odd, but if you want to match the action to another shot, you'll want to do that. If, for example, I had a shot right here, this gentleman's just about to jump off the ground. Right here, he's got both toes, if you notice, on the ground. If I happen to have a two-camera shoot, and I have a wide shot of him, and I wanted to match my footage from this close-up of his feet to the wide shot, at that exact moment when his foot comes off the ground, I could cut to the other footage and it would match the footage between cameras exactly. That's what this is for. Now there's other buttons, but they're not necessarily important for a beginning training. But just know that you can step forward or back one frame at a time, or hit play at normal speed. Let me talk a little bit more about some of the things in the timeline that are important. One of the things you can do is you can lock a channel so that you don't accidentally change it. This little lock key here is a toggle switch. You click it, it's on or off, locked or not. And then what that means is I have now locked this channel and I can't do anything to this channel now. You notice how in the timeline there's some dashed lines? Let me come to the end here and click the override button and notice that nothing happened. Click the override again, nothing. If I change to track two, this shot of the person swimming will come in right here in my timeline at track two. Why? Because track two isn't locked, whereas track three was. To unlock it, you toggle, click back and forth, and it lights up blue when it's locked. The track also gets this sort of dashed line look, so you know it's locked. And you can do that with audio tracks as well, if you don't want to change them for some reason. Maybe it's a voiceover track or something, or an audio track of two dialogue, and you don't want to make a mistake and delete it, so you lock the tracks and you can easily prevent any mistakes from happening.